Hi and welcome to the Open Tech Lab. In today's video, we're going to be doing some experiments with this little board I've recently acquired. It's an RF synthesizer board, and it's programmable, and it's capable of producing any frequency, pretty much, between 35 MHz and 4.4 GHz. And the board itself is powered by the ADF4351 chip by Analog Devices. Now, these boards are extremely cheap. They're available for sale from eBay for about $27 and at a similar price from AliExpress. And this price is really low. I mean, it's much cheaper than the sort of price you'd have to pay for various professional grade benchtop equipment. And so even though it probably won't perform as well as these kinds of instruments, the question is, does it have a purpose? Can it have a place in the lab as a poor man's frequency synthesizer? And I'm interested in getting this thing going, powering it off USB and controlling it with a PC so that it can be used for various automated tests and experiments. And it also offers the potential to be able to produce a carrier frequency for any kind of RF transmission. So in this video, we're going to be having a look at what the board can do, what it's capable of, testing its strengths and its weaknesses. And we're also going to have a more general look at how these kinds of frequency synthesizer chips work. So let's get started. So let's take a closer look at what we've got on this board here. So of course, at the heart of the board, we've got the ADF4351, which is the synthesizer chip. And then we've got a whole bunch of passives that support this chip. We've got the loop filter, which I'll talk a bit more about later. And we've got a filter on the output here. And we've got two output channels, two SMAs. And the chip basically puts out two versions of the signal, one of which is the inverse of the other, which is quite a handy feature. We've got a little LED here, which tells you when the frequency is locked on correctly. We've got a little power LED here next to the power input jack. This can take DC at 5 volts to 9 volts. We've got a little regulator, and we've got a 10-pin header here that feeds in the control signals. And then over here, we've got a 25 megahertz crystal oscillator that provides the reference frequency that the synthesizer uses to generate the output frequency. Then if we have a little look at the board under the microscope, you can see that there's an unpopulated footprint for an SMA connector here adjacent to the crystal. And there's this unpopulated R8 here. So if you don't like the crystal, if you don't think it's precise enough or whatever, you can remove R5 and populate R8. And then you can feed in a reference signal from an external source, which might be preferable. And we'll test this crystal out and see how well it performs later on. Then if we flip the board over, you can see there's nothing on it apart from these 5 10K resistors along here. And I really don't know why they bothered doing a double-sided load on this board. It seems to me that they easily could have just made this a single-sided load. Could have saved themselves a few cents in the production. Now, I'm just looking at the soldering under this thing while I've got it under the microscope, and I'd give it a 2 out of 5 star rating maybe. It just looks like there's a bit too much solder on some of these joints. It all looks a bit blobby. These joints here have merged together, so it almost looks as if most of this has been hand soldered, except I'm not sure if that would be the case for the chip in the middle here. So maybe this was oven baked on and the rest were done with hand soldering. I don't know, but it's all right, it works. Now, right after I'd ordered my board, I realized that I might have made a bit of a mistake in choosing the one that I did, because it was basically the cheapest one on offer. But I realized that I had no way of actually controlling the board, because the only control interface it offers is via the SPI ports. So I had a look around at AliExpress to see what the other alternatives were. So, for example, there's this board for $54 delivered, which features a little touch screen, which looks quite nifty. There's this product, which looks quite nice. It's in a metal box, and that would be very nice to have. But the price is a little bit high. $111 delivered is a little bit high by Chinese standards, especially for what you're getting. So I'm not sure about this one. Then there are these two boards. There's this one, which is a USB powered board. And there's also this one, which is very similar, also USB powered. Now, if we have a look at both of these listings, you can see that it references this software by Analog Devices, and this one does too. And I was having a careful look at it, and you can kind of see in the image that both of these devices actually feature the Cypress FX2, which I've spoken about in the previous video about logic analyzers. And this chip, of course, is very flexible, so it's no wonder that it's popping up in different products. So it began to make me think, could I construct something with the same hardware as this? Because basically what this is with this software that's being offered here, this is official control software by Analog Devices. So basically these two devices are both just Chinese clones of the evaluation board. Now, the official evaluation board by Analog Devices looks like this. And like I say, as far as I can tell, this has very, very similar hardware to those USB-powered Chinese boards in AliExpress. And it has the Cypress FX2 and it has the ADF4351. I think the only difference I can see is that rather than having a crystal oscillator, it has a temperature-compensated crystal oscillator, which would mean that it would have much more stable frequency performance. Now, if you're interested in purchasing one of these official evaluation boards, you can find it on DigiKey, selling for $164 or so, plus tax and shipping. Now, I do find this price a little bit high, given that all you're getting on the board is a couple of chips and some connectors. And it does make me rather wonder why the board is so expensive. And it's something I've noticed with quite a few evaluation boards from various semiconductor manufacturers, is that the price tends to be quite high. And I always wondered why this was the case. I always thought that it would make rather more business sense for them to, you know, sell the board at pretty much cost price and encourage the uptake and usage of the chip. But there we go. So if we have a little look at the board schematic of the official evaluation board, you can see there really isn't much to it. On the first page here, we've got the ADF4351 and the supporting passives and so on, and the crystal oscillator, TCXO. And then on the second page, there's nothing here, just a couple of regulators. And then on the third page, there is the Cypress FX2, the USB microcontroller. And, oh yeah, and there's this 24LC64, which is a 64 kilobyte I2C EEPROM. So there really isn't much going on this board. And the key thing is that the only connections between the two chips are clock data and link enable, which are analogous to an SPI link. This is an SPI compatible link between the two chips. And it's unidirectional. So data only flows out from this chip to the ADF4351. No data is ever reported back to the Cypress FX2. It's a write-only link. Now, I'm slightly baffled as to why they actually chose the Cypress FX2 as the microcontroller to this board, because this is a really expensive chip. Looking at DigiKey here, it's selling for $9.36 in units of 100, which is a really expensive microcontroller. And added to which, the SPI bus is not wired to any dedicated SPI controller in the FX2. It's just wired to some general purpose IOs. And therefore, the program that's running inside the FX2 is just bit banging the GPIOs here. So when you pay the extra money for the Cypress FX2, what you're really paying for is that fast path between USB high speed and the parallel bus that allows you to stream, you know, at 300-400 megabits per second out over parallel, which is an amazing feature. And for this application, the microcontroller only has to bit bang a couple of IOs, which is something that practically any USB microcontroller could do easily. And therefore, it's really baffling to me why they chose to use the Cypress FX2 and why they didn't choose to use really any other USB microcontroller. There are USB microcontrollers available that can do everything the FX2 needs to do on this board for a dollar or even less. So having seen the board schematic, we can see that it really isn't very hard to replicate the hardware of the official Analog Devices board. So all we need to do is combine the Chinese ADF4351 board here with a board, any board, that has the Cypress FX2 on it. Now, you'll have seen me talking about this board previously in my little video about Sigrok and logic analyzers, because this device can be used as a very, very low-cost logic analyzer because of the Cypress FX2's ability to feed in a parallel bus up into USB. It can be used for the purposes of as a logic analyzer, and that's something that is very useful, and it's something that Sigrok provides very nicely. But also, these boards are quite flexible in other ways. They can feed out data very fast, and in fact they're completely programmable. They have an 8051 core inside, so they can be programmed to pretty much anything you might want to do over USB. So these devices are very handy, very flexible, and it's well worth having a few of these lying around the lab, because you never know when you might want to, you know, grab some data and feed it into your PC or whatever. And if you're interested in purchasing one of these devices, you can find them on AliExpress. They're usually available if you search for FX2LP board, and you usually should be able to find them on sale for about $5 or so. So, you know, it's well worth having these ready to go. And in this case, all we need to do is wire up the Cypress FX2 board to the ADF4351 board. So I've gone ahead and wired everything up, and of course I've got the synthesizer board up here and the Cypress FX2 board down here, and it's all been wired together. Now, it looks like a bit of a rat's nest, but there actually isn't that much in the way of connections linking these together. So all I've got from this side coming through is three SPI lines, clock, data, and chip select, although on the synthesizer board these go by different names, but it's basically SPI, no different from a normal SPI channel. And in the middle here, I've gone ahead and done my usual trick, which is to attach a logic analyzer between the two. So I've got a Sayley clone logic analyzer here running the FX2 LAFW open source logic analyzer firmware. So the idea is that we'll be able to see the commands that are being sent by the Cypress FX2 into the synthesizer over here. And then there's just a few extra connections to make on this side, because there are a few extra things that need to be tied to various voltages. So the synthesizer board is being powered by the FX2 board over here. It takes 3.3 volts coming over, and then there's a couple of other pins here that need to be tied up to 3.3 volts to enable the chip. But that's about all there is to it. And then out here I've got the RF signal coming down this SMA cable. Then at the back here, I've got my Rigel 1054Z 200 megahertz bandwidth oscilloscope, and that's wired up to the RF signal coming out of the synthesizer board. And I've got a little 50 ohm terminator here, which is needed to match the impedance of the synthesizer to the impedance of the scope channel. Otherwise, you'll get transmission line reflections and all kinds of nasty stuff going on. Now, as I say, the synthesizer board can generate signals all the way up to 4.4 gigahertz in frequency. But of course, given that the oscilloscope is configured to only have 200 megahertz of bandwidth, we're really not going to be able to see very high up the frequency scale that the synthesizer can produce. But we will be able to take some interesting measurements at the lower end of the frequency range, from that lower bound of 35 megahertz up to 200 megahertz. And it is also possible to exceed the stated bandwidth of the oscilloscope and see how much further we can go up before the signal disappears from the oscilloscope's capturing range. So now the FX2 board is connected to the PC, let's have a look at what the device comes up as in the USB listing. And to do that, I'm going to run LSUSB, and here we can see we've got a list of every single USB device connected to my PC. And the one that really matters is this device, the Cypress FX2 USB development kit. Now, this is just a pretty title for this code. And this is the vendor ID, this first 2 bytes, and the product ID, the second 2 bytes. And every USB device has these two codes, and they're used to indicate the manufacturer and what product specifically the device is. Now, what we're seeing here is the device in a generic unprogrammed state. And we're also seeing the device with no actual real device ID associated with it, because normally in the real analog devices board, it will come up with the vendor ID of analog devices and the product ID of the specific model of board. Now, because this is just a generic board, there is no vendor ID or product ID programmed into it. And the other feature of the Cypress FX2, which I mentioned in a previous video, is that typically the firmware is not flashed into any kind of EEPROM or anything like that. The software is typically loaded into the chip at runtime. Now, of course, the benefit of doing this is that it means that it's really easy to keep the firmware for the device up to date, because it's not stored inside the device, it's just downloaded afresh every time the device starts up. And so that's quite appealing to application writers, because it means that they just have to have a little firmware file that they download when they start using the device. So this means that although we don't have the product ID and vendor ID of the official analog devices board, and we also don't know what the value should be because we don't have the real board on hand, so long as we can find the firmware file that's going to be downloaded into this chip, if we download that firmware into the chip manually, then the chip will come back with the correct product ID and vendor ID. So even though in the normal product the chip would have that product ID and vendor ID programmed into it the whole time, we can get away with just downloading that firmware into it at the start, and then the application should be able to pick it up and use it at that point, even though we actually did the firmware installation already. Now, the official evaluation board control software is available as a free download from the Analog Devices website. And I'm not really satisfied with using this software in the long run, because this is the Open Tech Lab, so I want to be doing everything with the maximum amount of open source software. And added to that, I'm a Linux user and this is Windows software. And also, I really feel that this software was paid for through the cost of the Analog Devices board. So if I'm not really buying the official board, then I suppose I shouldn't really be using this software. But I think it's okay for us to use it just to get going with the setup that I have here. Now, here you can see I've got the software running inside Wine, and on the face of it, it's running pretty well. So you can see we've got a few tabs here, and the interesting one is this main tab, and it's got options for really every single feature of the chip. You can just set the register values and write them in to the chip, and it will go away and do whatever you want. And you can set the values manually in this tab, and it's also got this frequency sweep and frequency hopping mode where it can jump between different frequencies, so that's quite a cool feature. But unfortunately, even though the UI side of things is working pretty well, unfortunately Wine does not currently have much in the way of support for USB. And this is something that's a little bit frustrating, really, because it's quite often the case that I want to use some Windows software to talk to some gadgets that I have. Now, back in January, the Wine project made a major release of their software, Wine 2.0, and it has a whole load of information about the new features that it adds. And within the release notes, there's an interesting little comment here. It says, "A new driver architecture is in place for supporting human interface devices. This follows the Windows model with platform-specific bus drivers and HID mini drivers. It will be used in future releases to unify support for human interface devices and potentially also for USB device support." So from that, I take it that there are some moves in the right direction in terms of Wine's USB support, but unfortunately, it seems to be a little way off. So right now, Wine can't really be used to control USB devices. But in the not too distant future, give it a couple of years, I'd expect that support to begin to emerge. And that's one of the things that is quite nice about the open source ecosystem, is that these applications are here to stay. They're here for the long haul. They have a great deal of longevity. And by giving it time, I've seen features that I never saw possible emerge in the Linux ecosystem, which is a really good thing. Now, even though the software doesn't work in Wine because of the USB feature limitations, there is still a silver lining here in that the software did install correctly into the virtual C drive of Wine. And I'm just picking through the files that it installed. And here we can see among the all the different things that are here, this little .hex file, the ADF4XXX USB firmware 2.0. So this is the file that we need to load into the device to make it come up with the correct product ID and vendor ID, which is what we're going to need to do if the software is ever going to recognize our Cypress FX2 development board as a genuine analog devices evaluation board. So now let's try loading that firmware into the device and see what happens. So to begin with, I'm going to watch lsusb. Now what the watch command does is it re-executes lsusb every 2 seconds. You can change the interval, but 2 seconds is the default. And the reason to do this is that it will allow us to see devices come and go and see the changes that happen as we install that firmware into the device's RAM. And then we just need to go ahead and download that firmware. So let's use CYCFX2Prog, which is a utility for this specific purpose. And we're going to use the PRG command and specify the file name. And it's a bit of a weird syntax, but here we are. Let's go ahead and download the firmware. There we go. And the firmware has been downloaded. But there's one more step that we have to do. CYCFX2Prog. We have to say run. There we go. And the device has gone away. And it's come back as this analog devices device, this 0456B40D. So that was pretty successful, and now the device should be recognized by the Windows control software. So like I say, we can't run the control software inside Wine on my Linux machine, but we can do the next best thing, which is to run it inside a virtual machine. So here we have Windows 7 running inside VirtualBox, and I've installed the control software. So let's get that started, and it takes a second or two to come up, and here we are, it's running very nicely. Excellent. Okay, so VirtualBox has a really, really cool feature, and that is support for USB pass-through. So what we can do is we can go in this menu here, and we can select which devices we'd like to hand over to the VM. So I'm just going to select the analog devices board, and if we select this, it takes a second or two, and the device will appear as a USB device plugged into the virtual machine. So now, if I select this thing, oh, it's automatically connected. Very nice. So now we're connected and we're ready to control the board. Okay, so as I mentioned, I've attached a logic analyzer between the synthesizer board and the FX2 board so that we can see the SPI commands that are going from one to the other. So I've set up the three inputs, link enable, data and clock, and given them the appropriate names and the appropriate colors to match the wiring. And I've set up the sample count and the sample rate, and I've set the trigger to trigger off the rising edge of the chip select. And so the only thing that's left to do is click run here, and then we're ready to receive the trigger signal. Okay, so we're now ready to configure the board. So I'm going to set the frequency to output to 50 megahertz. And this is a good frequency to choose. It's something that the scope will easily be able to pick up and display. So all that remains to do is click the big button, write all registers. There we are. And we've not only have we got an output on the scope screen, but we've also collected the packets in SIGROC Pulse View. And one other thing to notice is that this little LED is now illuminated, and this LED is the lock detect indicator, which lights up when the synthesizer believes that it's locked onto the desired frequency correctly. Okay, so let's have a closer look at what we collected in Pulse View. So you can see here we've got 6 SPI packets being sent, and of course these correspond to the 6 registers that the ADF4351 has. And if we look closer, you can see that we've got 32 bits being transferred for each of these register writes, and we can go through them one by one. Now, of course, because this is SIGROC, we can use the wonderful decoding features. So let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to add an SPI decoder, and I will set the clock. The master out slave in should be set to DAT, and the chip select should be set to LE. So now if we zoom in on the packets we've captured, we can see what data has actually been transferred. So I'm going to zoom in on this first packet, and now we can compare it to the register values that were set inside the user interface. And we can see we've got the values at 00580005, which is exactly the value that was meant to be written into R5. And then if we head over to the next register right over here, we've got 00EC803C, which is the exact value that's meant to be written into R4. And And if we go to the third one, then we see again the exact value that was meant to be written into R3. So we see the six registers of the ADF4351 being written in descending order in these SPI transfers. And so SIGROC can show the exact values that we expected to be written being transferred over the wire. So to get a bit more detail on the meaning of these registers, I've pulled up the official Analog Devices datasheet, and on this page we get a nice little overview of the structure of the six registers. Now, an interesting feature of this device is that the bottom three bits of each 32-bit register are actually the register address. So the register 0, the three bits are 0, and register 1, it's 001, the binary number of the register that's being written to. So this means that the bottom three bits are the address that's being written to, and then this leaves the remaining 29 bits, which are the actual content of the register. And then within the register themselves, the various bits of information, the various values, are written in as bit fields, which are used to indicate the various values which are being set inside the device. So at the moment, all we can see in this output is the register values that are being written. So to make things a little bit easier to read, I decided to write a little ADF4351 decoder. So to use that, we need to select the SPI decode, and I'm going to click Stack Decoder, and then at the top of the list off screen, you've got the ADF4351. And here you can see it's decoding the various fields within all of these registers. So this one is a particularly well-populated register. And here you can see the actual decoded structure of the fields that are being programmed into the ADF4351. So if I was planning to do a lot of work with this chip, and I might well be, I'm not sure what I'm going to do with it, it's really, really handy to have this kind of information available, because it just means we can see at a glance whether we're programming the chip in the way that we mean to. Now, I want to show you just how easy it was to write this decoder. So here I am sitting inside my local libsigrok decode repository, and I'm sitting inside the directory of the decoder, and you can see there are these two files, init.py and pd.py. So let's check out what's in these files in order. And pd. So in this init.py file, there really isn't anything here of note apart from a little bit of documentation and this bit of boilerplate here. And then if we look at the pd itself, there's only 142 lines of code in the entire thing. Really, really short. And the total time it took me to write this was about 2 hours, and I was being distracted, and I don't write these things ever so often, so I'd kind of forgotten how to do it. But it didn't take me long to write at all. And there really isn't much to this thing. The main feature of it is this Python class here, decoder, and it's got a few different functions inside of it. The main ones we need to override are start and this decode function. And because this is a second level decoder, we're receiving all the different annotations that are produced by the bottom level SPI decoder. So what we do is we sift through all the annotations that we receive and decide what to do with them. So there's two annotations that I'm interested in. I'm interested in the annotation of the individual bits, and these annotations contain a start time and an end time, and then the user readable note of the value of the field. And then I'm interested in this chip select change annotation, which is used to indicate, well, when the chip select value changes. So when the chip select is released at the end of a register write. So the way this works is that every bit that's received from over SPI is sent through as an annotation. So we just accumulate these bits inside something that's akin to a shift register. And we accumulate with that the values of the start and end of each of those bit periods. And then when we get to the end of the register write, we'll get this CS change message. And we're only interested in ones where the chip select is released. And I'm only interested if there's exactly 32 bits that we've accumulated in the shift register, because any other value is undefined. And then the first thing we do is we read out the control bits here. And I've got this function called decode bits. And all it does is it sorts through the shift register and produces a big annotation that encompasses the period of the bits involved in that bit field. So we decode the bits of the control field, which is the register address, and then we make a little annotation of that and send that through down here. And then for the rest of the bit fields, the actual payload of the register, we go through and have a look at all the fields in a big table. So up here, we've got a big table that just lists the different bit fields that we might encounter in every single register write. So for example, this entry here says that if we're looking at register number 4, then there is a bit field that starts at bit number 3 and it's 2 bits long, and we've got one here that says it begins at 8 and it's 1 bit long. And then this final field here is just a little lambda, a little pointer to a function which can be declared in line the way I've done it. And this just declares some logic for converting the actual actual value of the register, the integer value, into some human readable text. And the meanings of all these registers was just copied in from the information written in the datasheet. So that's my complete overview of how this decoder works, and as you can see, it really isn't very complicated at all. And I hope this inspires you to try and write some decoders of your own. You don't have to be any great Python expert. And I went ahead and submitted this decoder to the Upstream SigRock project, and I got a little bit of help, a little bit of feedback on my design, but overall everyone was pretty happy with it. And the next day after I'd written this thing, it was included in the mainline libsigrock decode. And this is really awesome because it means that the decoder that I've written here to kind of help myself goes into the library of decoders for anyone else to use. So I am really keen just to encourage you, if you're working with a chip of any kind and you have the manual for it, and you're interested in having the facility that SigRock offers, it's well worth spending a couple of hours just writing a decoder like this, because it just makes everything so clear immediately. It just makes it so much easier to understand what's going across the wire. And then when you get that sent upstream, then immediately it gets added to this growing library of decoders which are available for anyone to use. And the library isn't small to begin with, but of course there's a lot more devices and protocols that could be added to it. So get hacking. So now we've got the Windows software running inside the virtual machine, I'm interested in finding out a little bit more about what kind of messages it uses to communicate with the Cypress FX2. And there are a few different methods around to capture USB traffic for analysis. But the way that I usually do it, and the way that is commonly used when reverse engineering protocols for the SigRock project, is to run the software for Windows inside a virtual machine, as we're doing with this software. And then inside Linux, running on the host machine, we would run USBmon, which is a feature of Linux that allows USB traffic to be captured. So let's have a look at how to set about that. Now, for anyone who hasn't worked with USB before, it's worth mentioning that it is a moderately complicated protocol. For example, the USB 2.0 specification is 650 pages long, and that goes together with numerous other standards for specific protocols for specific devices. So for anyone who's new to USB, it can be quite daunting trying to understand how it all works, which is why I recommend this guide by Beyond Logic. It's called USB in a Nutshell. It's an online tutorial that takes the information in the specification and breaks it down into simple terms and explains it in a simple way that's easy to follow. So I highly recommend looking through it if you're doing anything serious with USB. So let's have a little look at how to use USBmon. And as I mentioned, USBmon is a feature of the Linux kernel, and therefore we need to make sure that the USBmon module is loaded up. And as I believe in all of Debian, certainly in the Ubuntu family and Linux Mint, which is what I'm using here, USBmon is not loaded by default, which is presumably to save a little bit of RAM, which is a very good thing. But for our usages, we need to make sure that that module is loaded. So the first thing we're going to do is do sudo modprobe USBmon, and that module is now loaded, and we can confirm that it's loaded by going lsmod grep USBmon, and it comes out in the lsmod list. Now, the next thing we need is to take note of the device and bus number of the device that we're interested in. So I'm going to do ls USB to list all the USB devices. And we're interested, of course, in this analog devices board here, which is on bus number 1 and it's device 123. So next up, let's have a look at what we've been given by USBmon. So to do that, I'm going to do sudo ls/sys/kernel/debug/usb/usbmon. Now, what we're going to see here is not real files. This is in sysfs. These are virtual files that come from the kernel, and we're going to be seeing the virtual files that come from USBmon. And there we are. We've got a load of numbered files with S and T and U. And each of these numbers represents a bus. The bus is on my system between 0 and 8. And these files, you can read them, and they will give you a textual output of the packets captured from the device. So, for example, I'm actually recording on bus number 3. So if I do sudo cat/sys/kernel/debug/usb/usbmon/3u, we're going to see a whole spew of packets. There we are. Now, as you can see, we've got a few columns here. This is a address, and then we've got a timestamp, and then we have a bit of textual information containing information about the packet headers, the type of packet, the endpoint number, and so on. I'll explain those more in a minute. And then inside, we've got the actual bytes of the content of the USB packet, which is what we're really interested in. Now, when you capture the output from one of these files, you're seeing packets from every single USB device attached to that USB bus, including anything that might be attached to various hubs all plugged into each other. You'll see packets from all these devices superimposed on top of each other. And so very often you'll want to just filter by a single device that you're interested in, which is why we need to know the device number. So in our case, we want to read from bus number 1 to get that analog devices device, and I want a grep, and I'm only interested in lines that contain the device number of 123. And now you can see, well, there's no activity between the PC and the device right now. But now we can see if we can start a conversation between the device and the PC. So a couple of days have passed since I recorded the previous segment. And in that time, the USB device number has been reassigned from 123 to 006. So the command has had to change slightly, but the principle is still the same. And we're set up ready to capture packets on the left here. And on the right, I've got my virtual machine running Windows, and the device isn't attached to it yet through the pass-through. So we can go ahead and attach the USB device now. There we are. And now we're seeing a whole spew of packets going back and forth between the USB device and the analog device's control software. So to properly understand the meaning of the USBmon output, we need to have a look at the kernel documentation. This is usbmon.txt, and I will link to it in the show notes. And as we scroll down here, it gives a whole description of how USBmon works and what the output means. And as we go down, it gives a description here of the different columns and the type of message being transmitted down here, and it gives a complete description of what the different bytes mean. And when you first encounter a line that looks like this, it can be a little bit hard to read, a little bit hard to understand the meaning. But actually, when you do get used to the format here, this abbreviated structure is really, really helpful, because if you're comparing logs from multiple captures, it's really easy to see the differences in this abbreviated form. So now let's try writing some registers to see what happens. So to begin with, I will write R0 here. There we go, and you can see we've captured two packets. We've got a setup packet and a response packet below here. And in the first packet, this is a control output packet, and this is the interface and USB device that we're directing the message at. And then we have a few headers that are specific to control messages here. And then within the packet itself, we've got the payload bytes here. There are 5 payload bytes. And you can see the first 4 bytes here exactly correspond to the values of this R0 register, except that the endianness is reversed. So the last byte is first and the first byte is last. And then following on from that, we've got this 20 byte,
which I haven't figured out the meaning of it exactly. I'm not sure what it does. Okay, so that seems pretty straightforward. Let's try writing another register. Let's try writing R4. There we go. And you can see in the same way, it is exactly the same. We've got that 4 bytes of register data here, but with the endianness reversed, and then with that 2-0 addendum on the end. So you can see this protocol is really, really simple. I mean, we couldn't really ask for it to be any simpler than it is. All they've done is packaged up the bytes of the register value into a control message and added an extra byte on the end, and that is it. And this is just about the simplest USB protocol that I've ever had to work with, so that makes things very easy. So when reverse engineering USB protocols, it's quite essential to be able to test out various ideas about what different messages might do. And you want to be able to send messages to the device and see if the messages you're sending have the desired results. And so to do this, I usually use PyUSB, which is the Python user space USB library. And it allows you to send and receive messages from USB devices in a quick and easy way, and then you can test things out and see what they actually do to the device. And so here I've written a simple script that replicates the behavior of the things we saw in USBmon. So I'll just walk you through it really quickly. All it does is it starts off, finds a handle to the device with the given vendor ID and product ID, and then it gives an error if it didn't find it. Then it sets the default configuration, which is important if the device is being cold booted. And then it goes through and attempts to set the 6 registers of the device to these hard-coded values with this setReg function. Then within that setReg function, it does a USB control transfer with all the different headers and fields set to values that match the values we saw in USBmon. And here we have the payload being set up. It does the byte swap to reverse the ordering of the bytes here, and then it also adds on that extra 2-0 byte on the end. So let's see if our little test script actually works. So to do that, I'm going to run the script. There we are. And it worked. So now we have a way of controlling the ADF4351 that just involves Python and Linux, and we don't have to use Windows or the analog devices control software. So while we're on the subject of USBmon, I'll just show off a couple of other tricks quickly. So if we want to log the packets that we're capturing, we can just cat them and pipe them into a file before.cap, and I'll click a button in the GUI in the background here, and let's see what packets we captured. There we go, 6 USB transactions. But of course, the problem with this method is that we can't view the packets that are being captured at the same time as they're going into the file. So if we want to do that, we can do it by replacing this pipe to a file with pipe to the T command. And we can do T after dot cap. And now we'll be able to see the output at the same time as we capture it to after dot cap. So I'm going to change this and write registers. There we go. So now we've got some output, and it also went into the file at the same time. Okay. Now, when reverse engineering USB protocols, it's often very helpful to change things in the GUI, as I did just then in the background, and then compare the difference between the packets before and after. So the helpful thing about having these logs is that we can put them into a textual diff tool and then do a line-by-line comparison of the output. So here I'm going to use vimdiff, and I'm going to compare before.cap with after.cap. And there we are, we can see the differences, sort of, except there's a bit of a problem because we've got those addresses at the beginning of the line and the timestamps, which are never going to match. So there will be a complete difference across the board. So to rectify this, a little trick I like to do is to put cut-c29- before this one, and then do the same, cut-c29- after this one. And what this will do is just strip off the timestamp and address off the beginning of the line. There we are, and we can clearly see the bits that have changed between the two times I pressed the button in the GUI here. So I guess this would tell us something about the mystery protocol we're uncovering, except of course we know everything about these bits because of course they're all documented in the ADF4351 manual. Now, just as we finish looking at USB mon, it's worth mentioning that we don't necessarily have to capture the packets by streaming from the Magic file in DebugFS directly from the kernel driver. And so there are various front ends available which purport to make it a bit easier to understand the meaning of the data. And perhaps the most notable of these is Wireshark. Wireshark has had full USB mon support for a few years now. And so we can capture USB packets inside Wireshark in the same sort of way that we'd capture a network packet, which is pretty cool. So in this view here, we're selecting which network adapter we want. And I'm going to double click on USB mon 1 because I care about the bus number 1, which is what the USB device is attached to. So let's double click on that. And for some reason in Wireshark, I always get this group of 10 packets being captured right at the start anytime I begin capturing from a bus. But anyway, now we're capturing from the device. So the next step is to try and poke it from the Windows software. So I'm going to click on the big button on the virtual machine in the background here. There we are. And we've got a few packets and we can click on them and do the typical Wireshark things. We can jump in and see the different fields within it and all that kind of thing, and set up filters and so on. In some ways this is quite nice, and some people might find this nice to use, might find it helpful. But personally, I do find that in the end, when you get used to using USB mon on the command line and you get used to and understanding the meaning of the text, in a way it ends up being more powerful because you can do all those tricks with doing textual diffs and comparisons and grepping and filtering with regexes and things, which Wireshark can do some of that stuff, but it ends up being a bit cumbersome. And in the end, the command line actually ends up being a little bit easier, in my opinion. But, you know, you've just got to use whatever tool you think works best for you. Have fun with it. Okay, so now we've got that bit of reverse engineering done, I want to switch gears a little bit and have a look at how the ADF4351 actually works. And the chip itself is quite standard for these synthesizers. It uses something called a phase locked loop. And I want to explain how that works for the ones that don't know, because it's a very interesting circuit. So to explain how these phase locked loop circuits actually work, I've come over to Circuit.js to run a little simulation. So here you can see a very simple phase lock loop circuit, and this circuit is generating a frequency, an output frequency, that is matched to the input frequency. So we've got 120 hertz going in here, and we've got 120 hertz coming out, and the two frequencies are locked together. Now, you might be wondering what the point of a circuit like this is, and we'll come to that in a moment. But the main point to begin with is that we have a circuit that can generate a frequency that exactly matches a reference frequency. So let me explain how this circuit works. And really the core of this circuit is this component here, which isn't really displayed very well in Circuit.js. But this is basically a voltage controlled oscillator, which is a type of oscillator where the frequency of the output is controlled by the voltage of the input. So we can generate a wide range of frequencies just by feeding in a different voltage. But then the question becomes, how exactly do we feed in the correct voltage to get the frequency that we actually want? Because of course the output of this will be controlled by millivolts of swing in the input voltage. You'll get a very different frequency. And also these VCOs tend to have manufacturing tolerances. So even if you could generate an exact perfect voltage for the frequency you want, you wouldn't really be able to tell what voltage would come out from one VCO oscillator module to another. So we need some way of controlling the frequency. And in the electronics world, typically when we need to control something, we just set up a feedback loop to keep the thing in balance around the point that we wish for. So what happens in this circuit is that we take the output voltage here, the output frequency signal, and feed it into this component here. Now this is something called a phase detector. And the way this component works is that if one of the input signals is making a frequency slightly higher than the other, or if the phase is slightly out with the other, it'll make a series of spikes, a series of pulses. And you can see these pulses on this yellow line down here. And these pulses then feed into this filter, which basically integrates and averages the output. And so what is happening here is that we have this voltage input, and that voltage input is being driven either a little bit higher or a little bit lower until the circuit manages to get the output frequency to be exactly synchronized with the input frequency. So if the frequency is too low, the phase detector will make negative going spikes, which will lower the voltage of this capacitor, which will lower the voltage via this buffer amplifier, which will cause a reduction in frequency. And conversely, if the frequency needs to go up a little bit, it will start generating positive spikes here, which will increase the voltage of the capacitor and increase the voltage input to the VCO, and then we'll get a slightly higher frequency. And then when the two are perfectly in sync, we will get just a flat line coming out of the phase detector. And at that point, we can say that the phase lock loop is locked. So in our simulation right now, you can see the output frequency and our reference frequency are exactly locked together. But let's have a little look at what happens during startup. So to do that, I will reset the simulation. There we go. So here we go. This green line here is the VCO control voltage, the voltage at this node here. And you can see that the phase lock loop is driving the voltage to the VCO higher and higher. And the idea is that the frequency, which you see down here, needs to get higher until it matches the reference frequency. So over time, synchronization occurs, and these pulses from the phase detector get narrower and narrower because, of course, the phase and frequency of the VCO are getting closer and closer matched to the phase and frequency of the reference input. And of course, there's a settling time until the two end up in sync, and then at the end of it, it enters the steady state and generates a steady frequency. So let's have a closer look at how the phase detector actually works. And in this simulation, you can see we've got the reference signal coming in here and the output signal coming in the bottom here. And this circuit just consists of a couple of flip-flops, an AND gate, and some FETs. And so I won't explain too much about how this works. You can look it up if you're interested in finding more information. But the point is that the output signal is running slightly too low. So we need to boost up the voltage of the output to give the VCO a little bit of a nudge to give us a higher frequency. So at this point, you can see that we've got the input signal on the top row of the scope here, the output signal in the middle row here, and then we've got the output of the phase detector. And you can see that as the two waves beat in and out of phase, these peaks get fatter and fatter or thinner and thinner, depending on how closely in phase they are at any given instant. But of course, in any case, the frequency of this input does need to increase to match the frequency of this input. So let's go ahead and do it the other way. So what happens if we go to 125 hertz instead? And now we should see that the output of the phase detector, after a while, it will show us that we need to reduce the output voltage. We need to reduce the voltage being fed into the VCO. But we do actually have to wait a moment for a complete cycle of the system to complete. So here you can see the pulses are getting narrower and narrower and narrower down here. And then we get a flat line. Okay, and now we're getting some negative pulses here, which would drain some voltage out of the charge pump. And then, of course, if we have the two frequencies exactly the same at 120 hertz, now at this point, we're still getting some phase difference between these two oscillators. They're not in phase, as you can see in this scope here. And so the phase detector will still output some negative going pulses, which will continue until the output from the VCO is exactly synchronized with the reference. So let's have a little look about how we can generate higher and higher frequencies. So in this example, we've got many of the same building blocks we had from the original example. We've got our voltage controlled oscillator here. We've got our charge pump integrator here, and we've got our phase detector over here. But what we've added to the circuit is this flip-flop here, which is acting as a one-bit counter. And the effect of this is that the frequency signal that's being fed into the input is divided by two on the output, which means that the phase detector is comparing the output of the VCO divided by two rather than the direct output from it. And this means that the output signal that you see here is now double the input frequency, which means that we've doubled the input frequency of 300 hertz and we're getting out 600 hertz. So this is the method that the ADF4351 uses to generate the output signal. If we have a 25 megahertz signal coming in and we want a 100 megahertz output, then with this divider here would just have to be a divide by 4, and that would result in a multiplication factor of 4. And then when we combine it together with various other counters and dividers on the inputs and outputs, we can generate really any frequency that we happen to want. So let's have a look at the data sheet for the ADF4351 and compare how the block diagram of the chip compares with our simulation. And if you look closer, you'll be able to see a lot of similar elements to the simulation. So over here, you'll be able to see the phase detector, which feeds into a block for the charge pump. And there's a little bit of off-chip circuitry required in the way of capacitors and resistors for the charge pump. But then the output of that little circuit feeds back into this VTune pin, which drives the input to the VCO. And that VCO is being controlled by this voltage. And then the frequency that comes out of it goes round this way into the feedback path. And then rather than having a simple one-bit counter or a multi-bit counter, instead it's got a much more complicated division circuit. It's a circuit that supports all kinds of fractional division, which allows it to generate a much more continuous range of frequencies. And then, of course, that output from the division is fed back into the phase detector over here. So with those components, we've basically got the same loop as in the simulation, but with a bit more refinement. And on top of those things, the VCO core, because this chip supports such a wide range of output frequencies, it turns out that it has multiple VCOs for different bands. Because if you have one big VCO that's able to sweep through a huge range of frequencies, that means that the tuning voltage being fed in becomes extremely sensitive to noise and any kind of minute fluctuations in the voltage coming in. So instead, they have multiple VCOs in this core for different bands, and so the right VCO is being selected depending on the band of the output frequency. So that's one little refinement. And then on top of that, we've got an output stage divider that can divide the output signal by up to 64. And we've also got a bit of input conditioning from the reference input. So over here, we've got a doubler that can be switched in and out, and a 10-bit divider that's optional, and this divide by 2 as well. So this just gives the chip ever more flexibility in terms of the range of frequencies that it can synthesize. But the main point is that despite having a bit of refinement and a few bells and whistles, this chip is basically exactly the same as our simulation. So let's get back on track with the software side of things. So let's have a quick recap of the structure of the setup. We've got our control software by Analog Devices running inside Windows, running inside a virtual machine. And this talks to the Cypress FX2. And the FX2 is running the firmware from Analog Devices, and it talks to it over USB. And then the FX2 speaks to the ADF4351 and controls it over SPI. So what I'm shooting for here is a completely open source solution. I want to replace every single piece of proprietary software in this picture with open source software. So that includes replacing this Analog Devices control GUI, getting rid of Windows, I want to use Linux, and I want to replace the open source firmware with the FX2. But by doing that, we have a few opportunities. So for example, even though I only really care about Linux, of course, if I write the software, the control software in a cross-platform way, it will run on Linux, Windows, or Mac OS. And as I mentioned, I'm not that happy with the FX2 as a microcontroller in this hardware setup. So I'd really like it to be flexible so that any microcontroller could fill this role. But I think I do need to start off by writing an open source firmware for the FX2, because there are a lot of people out there who have the official evaluation board from Analog Devices, and they will depend on having an open source firmware that can use this chip. But of course, I'll be able to provide an alternative, so other microcontrollers that can talk USB and SPI will be able to fill in the role instead if we provide a firmware to do that. And the final thing that I'm hoping to get out of this is having some kind of scriptable interface. I like using Python for all my scripting. So if I could have some control software where I could control it through Python, then that means that I could write scripts that run various types of automated tests and feed in various frequencies into some kind of hardware setup and then automatically measure the results, and that will be really cool. So on the control software side, I need something that allows me to control everything manually, and then some kind of Python scripting interface that will allow me to control it automatically. Now, for the time being, I'm not planning to rewrite a version of the analog device's graphical user interface here, just because that's a little bit of effort that I don't really want to expend at this moment. But I suppose when I'm done with this, if anyone wants to jump in and help add a GUI to the setup, then there'll be an opportunity to do that. And of course, what I'm going to put together here is going to be completely open source, so hopefully other people will be able to join in and improve it if they think that that's something worth doing. Okay, so a couple of evenings have passed and I have been feverishly hacking away on the problem, and the result is this brand new GitHub project. It's called PYADF435X, which is not a very elegant title, but it basically encompasses what this is. It is a complete open source software suite to control the ADF4351 board, and it also can control the older generation 4350 as well. And within this suite of software, there are three main components at the moment. There is ADF435X, which is a Python library that can control the synthesizer via various hardware backends, and one hardware backend has been defined so far. And it is also a command line tool that allows the device to be controlled manually, and I'll show that in action in a moment. And it's also a firmware project, which implements an open source firmware for the Cypress FX2, so we don't have to rely on the proprietary firmware from Analog Devices anymore. So when you put all these pieces together, it provides a complete open source solution for controlling the ADF4351, and it works very nicely. Now, before we go on, I'll just show off a few things about this project. I don't want to show everything because it gets a bit boring, but I think there are a few interesting things of note. The first is the firmware for the FX2, which is in this directory. Most of what you see here is just boilerplate for auto tools. But what's interesting about this is that we can compile the firmware also using open source tools. So this is compiled with the SDCC, which is an open source compiler for the AT51 core, and it uses FX2lib, which is a library that exposes the various registers of the Cypress FX2 to make it easy to program. And then all these files are part of the build system. The only really important file is this C file at the bottom here, and this basically contains the whole code for the firmware. And as you can see, it's only 200 lines long. And all this firmware does is waits to receive 4-byte control messages. It doesn't even bother with that fifth 20-byte that the proprietary firmware uses. And when it receives that 4-byte message, it just calls this command setreg. And this function just does some crude bit banging to produce the pulses on the three SPI pins to control the ADF4351. And that is just about all there is to this firmware. So after I'd written a replacement firmware for the FX2, I needed to produce a replacement for the PC control software here. And in this project, I'm doing everything on the PC side in Python, of course, which makes it pretty easy to put together a basic solution that will do the job. And in this case, the role of the Python code is pretty simple, because all it has to do is take in values from the user for all these different various fields here, and then compose them together into the binary values that get written into the registers. And then it just needs to have some way of sending that off down to the FX2, which will talk to the chip, of course. So it's really, really simple to do, and not a very hard piece of code to write. But there was one aspect of the design which I was a bit hazy on, in terms of how it takes this RF frequency value and breaks it down and generates the correct divider values. Because with these synthesizer chips, there are often multiple combinations of dividers and multipliers that will generate the required output frequency. So I was interested in how it was selecting the various options depending on what frequency the user had chosen. But the thing about this software is it's written in .NET, which means that it is very, very amenable to decompilation. If you write .NET code that's closed source, .NET code is so easy to decompile, you might as well be shipping the source code. And for this purpose, there is ILSpy, which is a really nice open source project that just can decompile any .NET assembly. So if we go ahead and open up the executable for the ADF-435X software here, open that up. Let me get a little tree item here, and here you go. You can see we've got all the innards and all the classes on display. And then if I drill down into this main form class, somewhere in here there is a function. It's called build registers. It took me a few minutes to find this, but it's pretty easy to find within the software. And there you are. You can see we've got the whole content of the register composition algorithm laid out. And within this section here is the code that's used for calculating the different dividers and values that go into different fields depending on the input frequency. So they've made it really, really easy to find out how their algorithm works. Now, a little word of warning when you're decompiling proprietary software, in that if you're planning to write open source with it, you've got to be careful of the licensing concerns, that you understand what you're getting into. A lot of the time, software will have an end user license agreement with it, and so you will have said in the license agreement that you agree not to decompile the software. So that's one thing. And if you're taking proprietary code and making your own code from it, in terms of copyright, in many cases that would constitute a derived work, and so you're infringing the original vendor's copyright. So be very careful of that. But in this case, the software doesn't have an end user license agreement, for one thing. And for another, I really don't think that Analog Devices are going to have a problem with me taking this algorithm, because it will help them sell more chips. And also, I'm no lawyer, but I do believe that mathematical algorithms, mathematics, is exempt from copyright, but I could be wrong about that. The point is, I'm not a lawyer and I'm not giving you legal advice, but please be careful that you know what you're doing if you start decompiling things. So now I want to show the software in action. So to begin with, let me show the command line tool so I can run this ADF-435X CTL program, which is written in Python. And if I do dash H, we'll get the options for it. And you can see we've got a whole load of arguments that you can feed into this ADF-435X CTL tool. And that will just allow you to set pretty much anything you want about the register values. But I think the one that will be used most often is this freak value, which just allows you to set the values depending on the frequency you desire. And once that frequency value has been set, you can override the various fields within the registers with further options. And there's also at the very end these options here where you can override those values further with literal register values that you'd like to put onto the chip. Oh yes, and you can also specify what kind of hardware interface you'd like to use. At the moment, it just supports this FX2 based firmware that I've written, but in the future there will probably be other ways of talking SPI to the ADF4351. Now, to test out the synthesizer, I've replaced the oscilloscope in my hardware setup with this little black box here, which is an RTL-SDR software-defined radio receiver. And I'm not going to get into too much detail on this thing because, well, they've been around for a little while, so you may well know about it already. And also, I could do a whole separate video on it. But for the ones that don't know, basically, inside this metal box is a repurposed digital television receiver, and it talks to the PC over USB. And by repurposing this television receiver, we can use it as a generic tunable software-defined radio receiver that can receive signals all the way from 25 megahertz to 1.7 gigahertz with a couple of megahertz bandwidth. So I'm going to use this thing as a poor man's spectrum analyzer. So I've just connected it onto the synthesizer board here with an SMA cable. And then here I've got 30 decibels of attenuation with a little attenuator here. And that just prevents the synthesizer from completely saturating the input to this thing, because this is designed to receive very weak television broadcasts. It's not designed for being directly plugged into a synthesizer like this. So the attenuator is there just to absorb most of the power, just to leave a little weak signal behind that we can analyze. Okay, so to view the signal being captured by the RTL SDR, I've got this GQRX software, which is a nice, simple, graphical software-defined radio software, and it's nice and easy to set up, and it's got some nice features. It's particularly geared for receiving audio, which is useful for amateur radio enthusiasts, and it can receive FM for broadcast radio, or sideband for talking to other amateur radio, ham radio operators. And that's all very useful. But in this case, I'm just interested in the spectrum plot that we've got along the top half here and the waterfall that we've got along the bottom. And this is going to give us a nice view of the signal coming in when we activate the synthesizer. Okay, so let's see about getting the RTL-SDR up and running. And as you can see here, I've got the receiver tuned to 1 GHz, that's the center frequency, and we've got a couple of megahertz of bandwidth either side. And of course, we're not receiving anything at all, we're just seeing the noise floor as it floats past. Okay, so let's get that synthesizer up and running. And to do that, I'm going to use my command line tool, ADF435X CTL-freak, and set it to 1000 MHz. There we are, and we've got a nice tone coming through in the middle here. Now, if we look at the frequency of this tone, according to the RTL-SDR, that is about what? About just under 30 kilohertz offset from 1 GHz. And of course, the oscillator in the RTL-SDR is uncalibrated, as is the oscillator inside the synthesizer board, so these two are never going to line up. And also, you can see we've got a few spikes here, and this comes from the phase noise that's being generated by the synthesizer board. And this too, we can't really measure in a calibrated way, because of course the RTL-SDR is not calibrated. But the main thing it shows is that we've got a nice signal coming through, and that our Python code is working correctly. So let's have a closer look at this tone that we're generating here. So you might be able to see that we've got this central tone, and then it's surrounded by a little cluster of spurs around the base. So if we zoom in a little bit, we'll be able to see this in more detail. And you can see the spurs are distributed in a symmetrical pattern around the central tone. Now, these are a component of the phase noise, the jitter of the central tone. And because there's a certain amount of determinism, well, it's quite deterministic, they're represented as a pattern of smaller sideband tones that accompany the main tone. So if we had a nice pure tone here, we would not have any of these spurs. So that's the deterministic component of the phase noise. And then if we zoom in a little bit further, you might be able to see this skirt here around the central tone. Now, this is the random component of the phase noise, just random noise in the jitter. And one thing I've noticed that's quite interesting is that the phase noise, the random component, the skirt here, seems to come and go. So you can see that it's sort of going in and out. And here we go, it's come back up to quite a high level. And I'm not exactly sure what the cause of this is, but it seems to me that it must have something to do with the interaction between the VCO in the synthesizer and the reference. It seems like maybe the two are coming in and out of alignment or something. So it's an interesting phenomenon. I'm not exactly sure what causes that, but it's interesting to see it happening. Now, another interesting thing, if we zoom in a little bit further here, is we can have a little bit of a view of exactly how precise and stable that frequency that we're generating is. Because of course, these cheap Chinese synthesizer boards, they don't have a stable frequency reference like a temperature compensated crystal oscillator, a TCXO, or an OCXO, and oven compensated crystal oscillator, where the temperature is controlled in a little temperature stabilized little oven thing. And because it just has a simple crystal oscillator, an XO, there's nothing to stop this crystal frequency drifting around as the temperature in the room fluctuates. And so here we are looking, and on the left here we've got from left to right, we've got about maybe about 4 or 5 kilohertz of bandwidth is the span of this view at the moment. So what I'll do now is I'm going to blow a little puff of air onto the crystal oscillator, and we'll see what effect that has on the frequency. So to do that, I've got a little drinking straw. So I'm just going to give it a little puff of air. There we go. You can see quite a lot of drift there. Let me get in a little bit closer. And the span of the view, not quite that close. The span of the view is a couple of kilohertz. There we go. So you can see there's quite a lot of drift here, certainly of the order of several kilohertz drift. And because, of course, we're generating a gigahertz frequency here, we would expect to see a couple of kilohertz drift due to temperature, because that is a couple of parts per million, which is pretty much what you would expect from a crystal oscillator to get that level of stability with temperature. And it is possible to do better with a more stable kind of crystal. So let's have a little look at the harmonic performance of the synthesizer. And the thing about this chip is that it generates a square wave output, not a pure tone. And the analog circuitry on the board has very little to filter that tone in any way. So we're expecting to get quite a large number of harmonics. So let's have a look at what we're getting. So to show the effect, I've set the output frequency to 100 megahertz. And I've centered the RTL-SDR view on that frequency with the small frequency offset between the two oscillators on the two devices. So what we're seeing here is the central tone is at about minus 22 dB as measured on my very uncalibrated RTL-SDR. So let's have a look at the first harmonic. So I'll switch to 200 megahertz here. And you can see we've got a frequency down at about minus 69 dB. Let's have a look at the second harmonic. Okay, we've got a tone here at minus 31. Let's have a look at the third at minus 73. At the fourth at minus 37. At the fifth at minus 75. At the sixth at minus 39 or so. At the seventh, at minus 75. At the eighth, at minus 43. At the ninth, at minus 76. At the tenth, at minus 48. At the 11th, at minus. You get the idea. So we're all the way up at 1.2 gigahertz here. And I think if I go to 1.3, we've still got a very powerful tone here, all the way up at 1.3 gigahertz. So this chip is generating a lot of harmonics, a lot. So if you're planning to use this to generate a carrier wave to transmit something, you're going to need a filter of some kind to knock down all the tones except the ones that you want, which is perfectly possible to do. But this is one of the things that separates this simple little board from a proper bench oscillator, which would have all that filtering in and would give you a nice pure sine wave rather than a square wave with just dozens of harmonics stretching up into the gigahertz range. So let's have a little look at the scripting capabilities of the software suite. So here I've got a simple example. This just generates a little sweep centered around 1 gigahertz. And you can see it's pretty simple. There are a couple of imports from the software suite here at the top. And first we set up the device interface, which is over the FX2 chip. So we're communicating over USB. And then we have a big loop here that just generates a sequence of frequencies around the 1 gigahertz mark. And then we have a function which calculates the divider values. And then we have a function that generates the binary register values given the various parameters. And then we have a method here that goes and writes those values into the synthesizer board. And that's about all there is to this. So let's try it out. So I'm going to exit this and let's do python3 sweep.py. There we are, and we've got a whole load of values coming out. So let's have a look at GQRX and see what's happening. There we go, and you can see we've got a nice barbershop pole sequence of tones being generated by the output. And you can imagine that a script like this could be used to control some kind of automated experiment where we feed in a known frequency and then measure some results or something of whatever the experiment produces. So it's quite a useful feature. And with a slightly different script, we can hop around in frequencies at random. So let's try this one out. So Python 3, random hop. Let's have a look at GQRX. There we go, and we're hopping around all over the place. Now for a final experiment, I'd like to show off the VCO settling effect as the synthesizer switches between frequencies. And to demonstrate this effect, I've got a script running in the background which is switching the output frequency between 999.5 MHz and 1000.5 MHz every 0.1 of a second. And you can see I've got the RTL-SDR receiver centered at 1 GHz in the middle here. And you can see it's switching back and forth up the top. Now, if we look at the waterfall down the bottom, you can see that we really can't see any of the transitionary behavior as it switches between frequencies, because it's all happening way too fast. And so to capture the effect, to see the switching behavior in action, I'm going to make a little recording of the RF waveform data being captured. So to do that, I'm going to just click up here. I've got this IQ recording and replay tool. So I'll just click record very, very briefly because I only need to capture just a single instance of the switching. So let's go ahead and do that. Record, stop. There we go. Really, really short. And that's all I need. Okay, so let's see about analyzing that RF data that we just captured. And to do that, I've got this software. This is InSpectrum, which is a really cool new open source project for analyzing RF data in detail. And I love this project. It's really cool what it provides. But unfortunately, the user interface is a little bit, shall we say, primitive. Not complaining, though, because it provides an awesome, awesome function. But if anybody's interested in putting some effort into this project to improve the user interface, I think it would be really, really great. I'd love it if this thing would get a bit more usable. But the point is that even as it is, it provides a powerful function that I will show off with our capture. So the first thing I'm going to do is open up that captured sample file that I just recorded. So I'll just pull that up here. Here we are. And there we are. You can see we've captured, you can see we're looking at the captured sample data in the UI right here. And in the brief period that I recorded for, 0.38 of a second, you can see we've got a few different switches between those two frequencies. And you can see that there's some interesting transitionary behavior as we flip between one frequency and the other. Now, in Spectrum, you can control the FFT size. And the thing about an FFT size is that there is a trade-off here between a small FFT, which gives you very, very fine time resolution, or a large FFT, which gives you very, very fine frequency resolution. It's a bit like the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. You can't know frequency of a waveform and the timing of that waveform with the same FFT without trading one off against the other. So if we make the largest FFT here, you can see that we get a really, really tall view here. Oh, it's really ground to a halt. I'm going to shrink that down a bit. You get a really fine resolution view here, but we lose quite a lot of precision with the timing. So now let me zoom it out to the very, very smallest FFT size, because for this application I need the very, very highest time resolution here. And what can we do? Okay, there's our transition. And we can zoom it in a bit so we can get a bit more of a fine view of the edge. Okay, so you can see the moment the old frequency goes away, and then you can see the new frequency up here kicking in. Let me just move this into the middle a bit more. There we are. In fact, I'll zoom it in a bit further. You see what I mean? It's a bit cumbersome just getting it to. It would be nice if all this could be done by dragging things around on the canvas in the middle here. But okay, so you can see there's a definitely a settling here. So you might be able to see this cloud here is sort of wiggling around the center line, and then it settles onto this final frequency over here. Now, to get a bit more detail on what's going on, I can add a derived plot, and I'm going to add a frequency plot, which basically adds an FM demodulator to what you see here. Now, what we can do is drag this little bar here to control the window that the demodulator uses, and there we are. You can see the phase lock loop, the VC and the VCO, of course, settling on the final frequency over here. So you can see there's a huge amount of oscillation. All of this value is a bit meaningless because the cloud of power is outside the bandwidth. But as we all the power enters into being within the bandwidth, you can see our waveform here settling around that desired frequency. And if we narrow this down, it reduces the amount of noise because this background noise in navy here is being filtered out of the frequency plot. And so you can see, if we put the cursors on here, we can see that there's a settling time of, I don't know, we're looking at about 170 microseconds. So here you can see within spectrum, we've got a really, really fine resolution view of the signal that's being received from the synthesizer. And you can see in really fine detail how that frequency that's being generated settles onto the desired frequency. And of course, as this is happening, the phase detector will be, sending pulses into the charge pump to get that voltage just right, to feed the right control voltage into the VCO, and little by little the VCO output frequency will converge onto the reference frequency, and by the time it's finished, somewhere around here, not only will the frequency be matching, but also the phase will be matched up with the reference frequency. Well, that just about wraps it up for this video. I hope you found it interesting. We certainly took quite a roundabout approach to getting this board up and running, but in the process we made some useful open source software and we covered some interesting topics. So I think it was definitely worth doing it this way. And going back to the original question, can this board replace a real benchtop synthesizer? And I think the answer is probably no. I mean, a benchtop synthesizer would radically outperform this board in terms of harmonics and frequency stability and really any parameter you care to mention. But at the same time, I think this board is still very, very useful. And especially because it is a very, very cheap ticket into the gigahertz band. I can't really think of a cheaper way of creating a stable 4 gigahertz tone. So in those terms, I think this board has a lot of potential. And so I'm planning to use this board for a series of videos that are coming up where we'll try and apply it to various RF problems. And so there'll be a few more videos coming up on this device. Now, make sure you check out the show notes for information about the various pieces of software and equipment that were used in this video. Hopefully that will be able to point you in the direction of anything you need. And if you like the video, give it a big thumbs up and subscribe. And I just want to close by welcoming all the new subscribers who've signed up to the channel in the last month. A lot of good people, I'm sure. And I really hope that these videos that are coming up, that they benefit you in some way, that you find them useful or interesting. So hopefully I'll see you at the next video on the Open Tech Lab.